Adele has crossed over. She's slim now. And she was always an attractive woman. Always. But now she's even more attractive. Now Adele is a Helen. And she's getting Helen treatment. But is she ready for it? And might you also be a Helen? Very, very curious about that. Okay, so now we're getting warmer. We're seeing a trend now where certain people do not like other people who work hard and are self-actualized, or they're working towards self-actualization. It makes them feel bad about themselves. I'm going to revisit social comparison theory briefly and then on to Helen. According to social comparison theory, people evaluate their own social and personal worth based on how they compare to others. So there are three comparisons that you can make: upward comparisons, downward comparisons, and similar comparisons. When you compare upwards, you'd be comparing yourself to someone more advanced than you or higher up than you, someone essentially above you. And you would either aspire to be like them if you are a person who's confident and goal-driven, or that person's success or presence would make you feel bad about yourself. It would give you a poor self-image. If you're already a person that has low self-esteem, you're going to have even lower self-esteem now around this person or thinking about this person. And I want to know, when it comes to this sort of thing, if you're very attractive, if you're slim or fit, if you are biracial, or if you are light-skinned, you're an upward comparison. If you're an intellectual, you're an upward comparison. If you're upper middle class and above, you're an upward comparison. To most Black people, they would consider you more successful, and therefore you will be subject to the envy that comes with upward comparisons, or they'll aspire to be like you, get where you are. Now, this is pretty much across all races, but it's really serious in the Black community because of the scarcity of opportunity and resources. Now, downward comparisons. That's comparing yourself to someone else that you feel is beneath you, someone that is doing worse than you. This would give the person confidence, and they think to themselves, at least I'm not that guy. It would boost their self-esteem. It would boost your self-esteem that someone else is doing worse than you. Downward comparisons can include the disabled, the elderly, and even children. Downward comparisons can, of course, be made towards people of other races or class, like I've mentioned in past videos. Similar comparisons are what they sound like. You're comparing yourself to people on the same level as you. This is the safest, most comfortable comparison to make. Now, what's going on with these types of people today is more sinister than it sounds. These people make up most of the population today. And these people want people that make them feel insecure to die. And I'm not being dramatic. They don't want change. They don't want fairness. They don't want inclusion. They want elimination. Men who can't get the women they want. Women who can't get the men they want. Women who can't get the type of body and features that they want. And the same kind of goes for men, even though men eventually can get over that. Men usually eventually get over that, and they focused on their money. People who are insecure about their lack of accomplishments in life and their laziness is apparent, they're also in this category. These people were born with brains that are wired differently than most. This is a developmentally stunted brain that lacks theory of mind. This means that it is inherently narcissistic, meaning that they have a dominant interest in oneself. That's what narcissism is, literally. So what they think, what they want, see, feel is what everyone else does or should, according to them. These people are disturbed when other people don't do what they want, don't see things their way, or when other people are not in their image. I talked about all of this in past videos. So, without further ado, enter Helen.
In Bridesmaids, Annie is crippled by low self-esteem, so it follows that the villain of her story is a woman who seems specifically designed to make her feel inadequate. Helen embodies everything Annie wishes she was. She's wealthy, has married well, and is exceedingly pretty.
You're so pretty.
It's nice to meet you. You are so pretty.
Oh my goodness, how sweet.
The evidence of Helen's unhappiness is blatant, right there out in the open.
I shared things with you that I've never shared with anyone, painful things to do with my family and the pain I've caused them.
Annie just chooses to overlook it.
It just gives the pill a little kick that it needs. Honestly, I do it all the time.
Her stepkids clearly despise her.
Off, Helen.
Okay, put a quarter in the swear jar.
So cute.
Sweet kiss.
The miserable Helen reveals that Annie's problem isn't that she's not desirable, successful, or rich enough. It's that she's wasting time wanting to be a Helen.
She's actually really cool, Annie. She's a good one, I'm telling you.
At last, she's found someone who likes her for her.
You made me realize how I can trust people again.
Well, I'm sure if you like her, I will like her, and
you have to just get to know her,
yeah.
Which I think you really should. And will you just do me a favor? Would you just hang out with her once, just two of you, right? As a favor to me. Okay, I will. I love you, Annie Lou. Bye. Bye.
Oh, hi, I'm Helen. Oh, you live in Milwaukee? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, have you met Lillian? Oh, she's my best friend. Oh, yeah, I know we've only known each other for 5 minutes. Oh.
First, this movie, just like every other movie, paints the attractive woman as the villain and the insecure, relatable women are the heroes. And I just wanted to make that known because that's been a trend for the past couple decades. So, some things about Helen. Only women comfortable with themselves can be friends with Helen or friendly with Helen. But on the other end, insecure women who don't like Helen get mad when Helen is not their friend. It triggers them. It makes them very angry that they can't get close to Helen, even though they don't necessarily like her. It makes you question why you want to be so close to Helen if you do not like Helen. People tend to take it personally when Helen's not buddy-buddy with them too. And some people, both men and women, become obsessed with Helen. They take great offense when she's not friends with them. And it's within her right to choose who she wants to be friends with, right? But they don't understand that. They don't care about that because Helen is actually an inanimate object to them. She's not a person. Also, if Helen's not best friends with you, it must mean that you are, insert insecurity here. So it must mean that your teeth are so yellow. It must mean that you're so ugly. You're such a loser. It must mean that you're so short. She's not into short people. A lot of projections placed on to Helen. Now, friendships. Helen's friends secretly hate her, and she has to watch out for sabotage from them, too.
First, I guess you need to know something about them. The beautiful ones, the flawless four. Everyone wanted to be them. You know them, they went to your school, too. They totally ruled. The one in green, that's Courtney. She was the leader, she was like Satan in heels. The blonde, Marcy Fox, a legend in her own little mind, known to herself as Foxy. The leggy one with the pigtails is Julie, doomed to be popular because of that face. And because she was best friends with the one in the pink. That's Liz Purr. She was special. Everybody loved Liz. Not just because she was beautiful and popular and rich and smart, she was all of those things, but more than anything, she was sweet. Courtney ruled with terror, but Liz ruled with kindness. She was like the Princess Di of Reagan High, and that pissed Courtney off. Liz Purr was just Well, she was perfect. I used to dream about what it would be like to be her. Elizabeth Purr. It's a shame about what happened to Liz. That was no way to wake up on your 17th birthday.
Take her and stuff her pretty face with pancakes. Then we're gonna tie her to the flagpole in her bra and undies and watch the fun begin.
Woo!
One is for witch, two is for bitch.
Pop it, Marcy!
Surprise! Oh my God.
What happened to her? What's in her throat?
Courtney?
Oh my God. Oh my God.
This is a joke, right? This is a total joke. Say it's a joke. Leave me lying here.
And by the way, Helen is a very, very good source of supply for the female sociopath. Everybody's envious of Helen, so obviously it's going to be easy to socially destroy her because people don't want to see her win. Most people who know Helen, most people around Helen, don't want to see her win. It's unfair because they feel like she's already on top. So this is how female sociopaths destroy people. They use that. And they use people against Helen. Schadenfreude is to the max with Helen. It's delicious to see the pretty girl lose. So no one's going to question or challenge the smear campaigns against Helen.
This is the first time I've ever seen you look ugly. Me kind of happy.
Vulnerability won't make people like Helen. It works for everybody but Helen for some reason. People enjoy her pain. So if Helen opens up, it'll be used against her somehow, and she'll be kicked when she's down if she's open about things. Helen can only be open with secure, good-natured people, and those people are kind of hard to come by. Now, speaking of people who experience hardship, but it's ignored, I can think of other people in society who are in that category. Even without privilege, without money, without good looks, these people are still in the Helen category. And this is because in whatever society they live in, those people have been chosen to be the scapegoats, and every society pretty much needs a scapegoat. So everyone in that society wants to believe that the people a part of that group are Helen's to justify why they treat them the way that they do and why they think what they think about them. Now moving on, romantic relationships. Men who get Helen are usually narcissists or sociopaths. Those are the most successful among us. So they tend to look for women who are close to perfect. And it's, you know, it's the trophy girlfriend, trophy wife thing. So she attracts a lot of those types of men. And if he's not one of those men, Helen might be with someone with whom she's mismatched in the looks department. He might be a homely man, but somebody that she's extremely happy with. But regardless, she's going to be judged. She's always judged. And with the homely man, she's going to be judged for not being with someone supposedly on her looks level. Generally, her love life and every other aspect of Helen's life is under extreme scrutiny and judgment. And she has to deal with that. Now, some may say that being beautiful and perfect can only work to a woman's advantage, but I think that that's only if you're a narcissistic personality or sociopathic or cutthroat Machiavellian type of woman. Or if you're a privileged woman who doesn't have to deal with the BS, maybe you have the money or social standing to not have to deal with toxicity like this, and you could just bypass it. Also, society won't admit this, but society even expects Helens to be terrible people, and they're actually disappointed with those who are not. When Helen is not a bitch, when she is not bitchy, God forbid Helen is nice, people reject that. People reject her. People don't like that because people deep down want to feel a certain way when they're with Helen, and that is beneath her. They feel that that is their place. Helens who aren't narcissistic, they also can't have opinions. Everything that she says is offensive. It's a personal attack on everyone else's self-esteem. Helen seemed close to perfect. Smart, beautiful, kind, talented. So much that people feel that she is completely unrelatable. And they feel envious and they don't like her. Okay, it's that simple. The reason why Helen's so perfect is because, one, she may actually be gifted or hardworking naturally. And two, that's mainly because no one ever helps Helen, and they deliberately try to sabotage or exclude her. So she had to grind and learn things on her own. People are extremely competitive, vindictive, etc. with Helen, and this helped her to sharpen her life skills. But on the other hand, it could have depressed Helen and given her some form of trauma and significantly affected her mental and emotional health. And Helen's know how people feel about her. So a lot of the time she may not put her best self out there because society seems to take offense when a beautiful woman is talented, and she knows it, and she's just happy. It's too much. It's like, how dare you make all these people insecure, Helen? What are you doing, Helen? Why are you doing this to us, Helen? You know? And Helen's just there existing. A lot of projections onto Helen. Ultimately, people punish Helen for being perfect, okay? And some people go out of their way to make life harder for Helen because she seems perfect and like she hasn't suffered a day in her life. Also, it's not Helen's beauty that people could be irrational about. It's her absence of flaws. Insecure people hate other people whose flaws are not visible because they're fixated on their own flaws and they develop low self-esteem because of them. And they believe that their flaws are so glaringly visible because they're fixated on them. But Helen, you can't seem to find any on her or about her, and it drives them crazy. Makes them green with envy. Makes them think that life is unfair and Helen doesn't deserve the life that she has. And then that turns into Helen doesn't deserve to live. What people need to understand is that sometimes Helen is just a self-actualized person who looks good at the same time. That's it. She could be just as hardworking, etc., 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 as everyone else. She just looks differently. Maybe she works a little harder than most to seem perfect. That could be because she's anxious, because she is expected to be a certain way. And when she falls off, even just a tiny bit, people make it a huge deal. Maybe try to embarrass her or just point it out. You know, it's like this huge deal that she is not perfect and everything is not in place. Because when you fall off of a pedestal that they put you on, they won't allow you to not feel that. Now, in certain environments, Helen cannot remain Helen, unfortunately. The environment won't allow it. But some very strong women do stay true to themselves and they can be Helen, even people without privilege, but she has to be very strong. But these types of people are out there. Now, I didn't talk about men because there are definitely male versions of Helen's, but he can't talk about it or else he's gay. I can't talk about it or else he's still gay. So I'm not going to bring up men. And there's a lot of women on my channel anyway. So how do you survive? What is the answer for Helen? The answer is simple. It's not to become a bitch, not to become a narcissist, because sometimes that crosses people's minds. They think that they have to play that role in order to combat everybody else's insecurity, but you don't have to do that. Just try to be true to yourself, learn how to defend yourself, check your ego, and remain humble. That's all. The only people you'll get support and love and help from are other Helens. So keep that in mind, or self-actualized people. And both of them are an extreme minority within the world's population. So you need to choose your circle wisely.